lot of you came up to my table today. Thank you for that. It's nice to meet you all. Have a good time coming out of here.
So, first question.
Yes.
What drew you to the entertainment industry?
What drew you to the entertainment industry?
What drew you?
I guess there wasn't a heck of a lot of other stuff that I felt that I could do as a kid. You know, I always wanted to be a performer from the time I was a little kid. You know, I got involved in plays in school, and so really I've been an actor since I was a kid. You know, got involved with all the productions and that kind of thing. I think I was dyslexic as a kid, and I think I had a lot of hard time keeping up with the other kids. You know, they sent you home a little book that said fill in the blank, and I couldn't read the rest of the sentence. I couldn't fill in the blank, you know. And, had teachers that noticed that, and I don't think it really knew what dyslexia was when I was a kid. They just thought I was disruptive and lazy. You know, no, he doesn't pay attention. You know, of course, I just wanted to participate. And usually it was in an entertaining way. And I found that to be, pretty much the talents that were given to me. So I tried to develop those as I went along. I think by the time I was in fourth grade, that teacher really noticed that I excelled. You know, getting up, I was going to say it so orally, that didn't sound right. But, so she let me do my tests orally and get up front of class where you have to go read the poems when we would all have to do poems and stuff like that out loud. And that's really what drew me to the entertainment business. I mean, it actually didn't draw me to the entertainment business as much as being an entertainer. Entertainment business as a whole is not an easy business, as a lot of artists find out, because most of us aren't really fit for business, which is more of a thing for the artistic end of it. But you got to learn it, or you got to earn people that know it in order to handle it, get you out there for that kind of thing. So, I've been doing it pretty much my whole life.
So, something that a lot of people might not know is you won Star Search.
I did win Star Search.
Tell us about being on the show there and how that came to be.
Well, that's a long story, but a great story. It's really, I thought, moving along the way of trying to become an actor, I went to college. I went to Towson University and studied theater. You know, I seriously wanted to be an actor. I loved stage acting. And I had people like Charles Dutton. I don't know if any of you remember Charles Dutton. He had a show called Rock a few years ago. And he was a black actor, great actor. Went from jail to Yale. This is a story, which isn't true. But in between the Maryland Penitentiary and Yale, he went to Towson, where I went and did a lot of plays together. So there's a lot of serious actors in there. And I moved to New York to do my first off-Broadway show. And of course, it closed after 2 weeks because of bitter fighting between the creative team and the money people. So that's pretty much the typical kind of stuff that happens. And found myself supporting myself by street performing on the street in New York in front of the Metropolitan Museum and trying to make my way as an actor in New York. And I never really was making very much money. I was there for 6 years in all. And during that time, I started developing a talent for trying to do stand-up comedy and sketch comedy. I worked in a sketch comedy group called Animal Crackers for a number of years. And off-Broadway show was coming, was going to the stage that we were looking for. It was a three-guy musical, I think Dream Girls, but stand-up comics. It was called Three Guys Naked from the Waist Down. Which is kind of how a stand-up comic feels standing in front of an audience when it's not going well, is the concept of it. And so I got the part of a very strange, dark comedian, kind of like an Andy Kaufman-ish kind of guy. And it starred myself and Scott Bakula and a guy named Jerry Coulter who wrote it. And we were three comics that were kind of oddballs, but together we excelled. Business, and that was what the story was about. It's a full scale musical with three guys, and all about stand up comics. And it was a hit off Broadway. And so, a talent scout from Star Search Star Search was the first year, and I was like, what's Star Search? And that was like 10 minutes after 2 hour. And they were like, oh, it's, you know, the show, all the comedians are doing. Okay, do you want me to come on as a comedian? And they're like, yeah. I go, you know, I'm not really a comedian, a stand-up comic. I'm just playing this part in this play. And they go, well, you win $100,000. I'm like, fuck off. I didn't know what I was going to do. You know, they said you have 2.5 minutes to fill, and coming from sketch comedy and street performing, I started taking some bits. I used to do my comedy group where I would do The Wizard of Oz in 2.5 minutes. Well, I would do it like 12 minutes, but, you know, then I would do it like in 5 minutes. But, you know, for this show, I whittled it down to 2.5 minutes, you know. And I think it got out a few munchkins in the witch or something like that.
As mayor of Munchkin City in the county of Landowise, we welcome you most regally. I had a man of high rule. As coroner, I must concur, I not only examined her, as she not only made we represent the lollipop here, the lollipop here, the lollipop here.
That's the castle of the Wicked Witch. Oh, Don, isn't that awful place? Oh, I hate to be in there. Fellas, we've got to get her out. I got a plan to get in there, and you're gonna lead us. All right, I'll go in here for Dorothy. Wicked Witch or no Wicked Witch. Got you know, guys, it's just one thing I want you fellas to do.
What's that?
Talk me out.
Anyway.
Sinbad in the finals, and Rosie O'Donnell in the semifinals, and won $100,000 as a stand-up comedian. And then they were like, oh, guess what? You're going to open for Tom Jones in Vegas. I was like, why? Fucking that. I'm going to open for Tom Jones in Vegas. And they were like, well, all you need is 20 minutes. I was like, okay, well, I've been on the show like 7 times, so okay, 2.5 minutes time. You know, so I put together an act based on a guy who was addicted to television, because I didn't really have any jokes and stuff. I was just doing these characters, and a lot of my stuff was based on pop culture, growing up through novels and children's books. And, they started looking at the Temptations and the Four Tops, and they won their TNT tour, and Rawls and Bobby Vinton, and all these big actors. My first 20 minutes of material. And then moved to LA and started working on the stage and the improv and all these different places. And I just kept getting cast in all these sitcoms and stuff. So my first series was First and 10, which was on HBO's very first series about football team. I played a Bulgarian field goal kicker. I could kick 60-yard field goals, you know, and I starred Delta Burke and Chris Maloney was the quarterback on the show for a while. And O.J. Simpson, of course, was the general manager on the show, and you probably would have seen it, but I think it got pulled off the air and O.J. slit his wife's throat. You know, I was really into the comic book as a kid, so I was like, they're making that into a show, how cool. It's gonna be awesome, you know? And they said, yeah, I want you to come down to Kevin Yeager's studio, he's working on the puppet, and you know, you'll audition for him first. And you know, I went down, they had all these other actors and the voiceover. And I could see them like reading this stuff, and they're like, be careful what you ask for, you make it. They're like, this is terrible. You know, they didn't get it, you know, they didn't get that. I could see he had all the rotting teeth and holes in his throat and that kind of thing, you know. And I'm sitting there going, okay. And that's, and I, you know, took a little bit of Margaret Hamilton, who was a buzz for the laugh, and I took a little bit of Alfred Hitchcock with the delivery from Alfred Hitchcock Presents. And, you know, it opened for Penny Youngman, you know, the cat steals after winning Star Search, which was kind of fun, you know, and a tiny comic. I said, I'd throw a little bit of a tiny comic into him. And, you know, made a little suit that came out of the Crypt Keeper's voice. And I did it for Kevin, and he was like, wow, that's like perfect. And the next day he had me doing it for Joel Silver and Richard Donner in the office, which are like two of the biggest producers in Hollywood. And they're like, okay, we'll see you on the set. And I just thought they were like jerking my chain. You know, you hear that all the time, and you never get the call. You know? And, I never really, you know, it was a very expensive show to do. And so, you know, they never really paid much. I got paid for a show like that for that many years of doing it. And I'm not going to say I didn't make money doing it because there were so many things that were tricky for, you know, Hawk, Bud Light, you know, Not Scary Farms and all this stuff over the years. But it was definitely something that was more fun to do than anything else. And, you know, 35 years of being an actor, if you have something like this that pops out, especially if you love horror like I do, and love the comic books that I do, and, you know, has a fan base that's like-minded, you know, it's really kind of cool that you have that as part of your resume. So that's kind of how I wound up here, to even extend upon your question. Probably for about 10 year questions.
It's good, actually.
Like a microphone hooked onto it, you know, and like a little microphone like this. He didn't even have a good setup for it to go audition, not like the normal voiceover job where you go into a nice studio where you record it at home now and send it as an MP3. And, you know, so it was completely whatever I created that day. And he was, you know, Kevin was putting together the Crypt Keeper, and he didn't have much money at first because they don't. Like I said, it was an expensive show, but they didn't also give you as much money. And the first show becomes a hit, then they give you more money to spruce up the show. It does. And so he was putting together the spare parts. A lot of people don't know this. A lot of some people do that. There's Chucky's eyes that he was using. Because he had created Chucky, you know, and made Chucky the doll. And so he had a bunch of spare Chucky eyes sitting around. And put them on, he goes, gotta keep those. That looks great. This particular one that you're looking at here was not the original one. If you look at the first season of Tales from the Crypt, you see the original puppet. And inside this is all rubber. You can tear this off after every show. It's all torn off because it was so thin it would tear up anyway. And they would replace it with the hair and everything with each show. And underneath it is a see-through plastic version of the Crypt Keeper with the eyes and all these little motors in them, the ones that servos, like the little motors that they use for animatronics, but originally were created for model airplanes when you fly with remote control. So you can, you know, remote control face that way, although Crypt Keeper, because they wanted it to work really well, had all kinds of wires coming out of it and that kind of thing. It took three people just to work the face. One guy, one puppeteer has on a head thing. Like this, you know, it looks like he's going to the electric chair and it has like a thing on it. And when he moved his jaw, moved the jaw of the Crypt Keeper, and then he had two over toppers to move, you know, the mandible and the bottom lip. So he could do this with it. And another person moved this part of the face and the tongue. And the other guy just moved the eyes. And then somebody else had one hand in the head. And then somebody else just had the other hand and then moved the torso. And then if they needed feet, there was this little woman that got underneath there, and she would have little feet. And that's when it took to choreograph, these guys choreographed. It's a whole style of puppetry that the Japanese created called Buraku, which normally we had two people working in. And so I would go in the studio and record, and they would watch how I moved, and I got stuff to try to incorporate it, and they could all reverse it. So, you know, if you look at the first season, because they didn't have as many servos and stuff in it, which is kind of fun. And then after the show was well received and a hit, that kind of thing, they gave him more money to spruce it up and now it can move faster and can be more comedic with it the way they wanted to. And I crack everybody up in the studio with a keeper as Marvin Lando or that kind of thing.
Stella!
Make a movie, you know, with Tales from the Crypt, and, you know, you get big stars involved, that's back then, you know, or you just probably didn't get as big of an audience as you did get now. Nowadays, it would be great to have a, you know, to do a whole string of movies. So, you know, I think that it could survive in that format. If I were going to do more movies, I would do them in anthologies. I would do two or three of them per movie myself. But, you know, like, definitely Demon Knight held up. Definitely Bordeaux with Blood held up. Rituals, which people ask me about all the time, is like, what happened to my mom? It was like, you know, the idea was good. It had a good cast. Had Jennifer Grey and Tim Curry. But it got caught up in, that one was made with Miramax, and the Weinsteins left Miramax at that time, so it got shelved, even though it was already shot. So it was originally released on another video without even the title on it. It was called something else, and it was called Big Easy or something. It took place in New Orleans for a movie and all that stuff. And it wasn't even associated with Tales from the Crypt. But then, you know, when they were, you know, launching, you know, the other Tales from the Crypt movies and, you know, the double box and that kind of thing, they were like, oh, why don't we get that movie back? We'll put the wraparound on it and we'll release it as a Tales from the Crypt movie. They did. It's a fine movie. It's not up to the standards of, you know, the Tales from the Crypt always have been, you know. So, you can see that it could be a pitfall with a longer format. It's gotten good. It's gotten good. I was telling somebody this story today about how they shot that movie. Ernest Dickerson wanted that too, the story set. How many people saw it in the night? Pretty good one, right? And then they have that two-story set, which is essential for people going down the steps, go upstairs, and all that stuff during the story. And the sound stages weren't high enough for them to build that two-story set, so they got an airplane under Van Nuys Airport. And the one that was available, the back end of it was being used to test jet engines. So they had split that, and they had a door open where they were, you know, all the time, where they were, you know, testing these engines when they weren't shooting. And so it was full of birds. So these birds were really noisy, you know, so they'd be like, okay, I'm ready to shoot. The guy pull out a magnum with blanks in it. You know, the birds would shut up for 10, 15 minutes and shoot a scene. Continue. So that was kind of like an interesting, interesting little tidbit, you know, while we're shooting it. But it was a good one.
Do you have a favorite episode of it?
Well, the Crypt Keeper's favorite episode is Upper Perv. That's the story where he gets born.
Yeah.
And that was directed by Kevin Dagger, actually.
Sure.
And also starred his brother, Jeff Dagger, who's a good actor. He's born from a mummy. He's a two-faced man. My favorite episode, The Pointless Love and Ends, right now, I'm just kidding. That's the one I was in. But anyone who works out on me. You know, if you were a real magician, you would have just disappeared. Some of my favorite episodes, The Man Who Was Deaf, which is actually this room, like it was And then he gets fired and had to reinstate that mountain. You know. And at the end, the Grim Keeper's sitting in the electric chair getting off on it.
Yeah.
You know, which I just thought was classic. You know, it was a classic way to start the show, and I think that's why they did. Because, so that, and he had got by Cougar to do the music, so, you know, that set a precedent for having, you know, really good composers attached to Tales from the Crypt and that kind of thing. Definitely some salesmen, Tim Curry, playing the mother, the father, and the daughter that they engineer the sale and trying to take a family. They wind up, you know, thought about the treasure downstairs, which is always a bunch of buried bodies. And Tim Curry was just amazing. Definitely showed me something. And,
what was the daughter's name?
That's a great episode. Ventrilo is a Dummy, directed by Dick Donner, is a great episode. Don Rickles. And, see, those are classic to me. There are a lot of different styles of episodes. That was the beauty of Tales from the Crypt. Every week, you could completely change the style in which the show is brought to you, depending on the story, the director, the actors involved, and that kind of thing. But they were always tied together with the Crypt Keeper, which was always done in the same style. So it made the show really very cohesive in so many ways. And there's been so many imitations with it, even Masters of Horror and these kind of things are great shows. But they just don't have, they don't have a built-in front man. They don't have their Mick Jagger, you know. They don't have their, you know, I love Mick Jagger with flips falling off. But, you know, so it's kind of a neat thing that Tales from the Crypt had that, you know, it was based on a comic book. And I think the ones that I enjoy the most are the ones that really feel like the comic books that I read as a kid. And those are definitely three of my favorites. I think the one that people say to me is their favorite more than any other one is All for the House, the Christmas episode, which was also the first season that Bob Zemeckis directed with his wife plays. And that's a remake of the one that was made in the 70s. The part of that story was done in the 70s version of that. But I don't know, people must find something really creepy about mixing Christmas with horror or something like Santa Claus coming into your house and hacking you to pieces instead of leaving you presents.
How was HBO able to get so much talent as far as writing, directing, actors? Is it just money?
Well, no, because they all work for scale. Joel Silver, Richard Donner, Bob Zemeckis, and Walter Hill, and David Giler were the biggest movie producers in the business at the time. You know, Joel Silver did all the Weapon movies, Superman, you know, Matrix, you know, all the Die Hard movies. So he could get pretty much anybody he wanted. So, you know, Bob Zemeckis, obviously, you know, Back to the Future, Forrest Gump, I mean, these guys could call on whoever they wanted, and people wanted to work on the show because of the playground. You know, they came in for a couple of days to a week. Yeah, they were a scale or whatever, but they were attached to, like, it was like a generation of Twilight Zone. Twilight Zone, if you watch Twilight Zone, it's got everybody. They had great actors. So it was an opportunity for people to do something really fun, and I think that, you know, I don't know that any that other people could have gotten attracted that kind of talent to it that these guys did. So, you know, it was a tall order to fill, and they asked a lot of favors of people because it was an expensive show to do. But they probably heard a lot of music along the way too. But you know, that's how sometimes you got to do it.
So, as an accomplished voice actor, when you're on a scene with another actor, you kind of feel each other's emotion. When you're just in a studio with a mic and yourself, what are some of the challenges? How do you motivate yourself to that?
Wow. Well, you know, I mean, it's different sometimes because, I mean, there are cartoon shows that I've done, like Cat Dog, which have, like, you know, it's like every Tuesday, they get the crazies together, and it'll be me and Tom Kenny and, you know, SpongeBob and all these other things, and Billy West, who's, you know, Ren and Stimpy, and Carlos Alberati, Rocco, and, you know, all these great voice actors, and we're just cracking each other up for the whole time we're doing it. I mean, that's nothing better than that. That's a lot of fun. And that translates into how well the performances come out. And And then, you know, you go do stuff like Klasky Chupo, or that kind of thing, or doing like Rocket Power, and maybe I only have one other act and work with the other with all that, you know, using scene movie or whatever. You know, and then other times, like games, that kind of thing. It's, you know, you don't have to talk to anybody at all. It's just a whole list of lines. You go and you do that one spot time, and you do that one spot time, and you go to the thing. And you depend on the director to give you a visualization of what's happening at that moment. And if you give them a different feel, you know, some of them bigger, some of them smaller, some of them realer, some of them more animated, and that kind of thing. Within what you're doing, as a voice actor, you know, they're happy and you have that talent to do that. So the rest of it's all visualization. You have to put yourself there, you have to imagine you're in it, and throw it out there. And, you know, when I went in an audition to play Nico the raccoon in Pocahontas, you know, I'm sitting in the waiting room and they call me in and go, I have not seen the script. They go, there's no script yet. I go, you know, because now there's talk in Disney movies. Well, this one didn't. They want you to do real raccoon movies. They go, oh, I could do that. Okay, well, you got to humanize it because he's going to be, okay, Nico runs along, he runs through a log, he gets out the other end of the log and he's over a cliff. He sees that, he panics, he starts to fall, he's fighting the air, but halfway down he notices that he's falling in the water, so then he goes into a dive, he goes into the water, the last minute he's trying to fight because he's afraid that they hit the water, but he goes in, he pops up, spits out the water, and shakes off the water, go. So, you know, I gotta visualize that, I become Nico the raccoon, mischievous, you know, the whole thing, put in little sounds. Make it sound like a raccoon, make it sound humanistic at the same time, and then, you know, and go through that sequence of action and do it. And they're like, okay, great. So that's, you know, a lot of it's just visualization and you know, using your imagination. And, you know, sometimes that's more fun. I mean, there's a lot of things I get to play as a voice actor that I would never get to play on camera. You know, I get to play, you know, I played Deadpool, you know, the earlier games of the Alliance and Legends games and stuff. You know, I mean, he's like, and originally he was more wiry and sarcastic and that kind of thing. Once they started making him more burly and stuff, they hired another actor. Just because his voice translated a burlier, more superhero-ish kind of guy. He's not that, to me, he wasn't that high. But that's taste. You know, some people, you know, maybe evolve things. It's their project. They spent years getting it to me. So you don't even have to say so sometimes. You just come in and do it. So, but it's, I get to play these, you know, animals. I get to play, you know, things that aren't even human. You know, things that are, you know, that are completely made up creatures and, you know, fun characters, old men, young men, little kids, women. You know, I get to play all kinds of stuff that I would never get to play on camera because I don't physically fit the bill. So it's a, in a lot of ways, it's freeing because of that. You know, obviously not having another actor play off can be tough. But you know, the other parts are quite free. And they hire a lot of people. We've all seen projects that just fell short, you know. It's like, come on, if they hire that actor. You know, okay, I know that actor's famous, but the kids don't care. You know, it's like we'd rather just somebody who does a good job with it, you know. You know, if you're gonna hire Robin Williams, he's gonna do a great job. You're gonna hire Tom Hanks, he's gonna do a great job. You're gonna hire Jack Black, you know, he's gonna do a great job. You're gonna hire, you know, and then you're gonna hire like some other actor that's not used to doing any kind of over the top kind of, I mean, or bringing their imagination to what they're doing. It's not gonna translate. And there are a bunch of people that are really good at what they do, and I'm constantly impressed with, you know, some of the talent voiceover business. And you know, hopefully it'll continue with that trend because there's so many people that can just, you know, they can get auditions from a lot of different people online now and go behind the union and that kind of thing, save money, and it doesn't always translate. The best games, the best stuff you see, the best animated features and that kind of thing. I've done their homework with the people that can do the job and they show up. You know, it's a lot harder than it was.
Any questions?
Yes.
Was there ever a line that you read when, okay, this is too far? That
the
pun was just way too ridiculous?
Yeah. Well, you know, it's like, I don't know if I can think of a single one. You know, there was a lot of them really strict. I mean, if you look at my Facebook page, people are writing stuff to me that just doesn't land all the time. You know, they're trying to do, but I think, you know, we have a exploding on there. And you're like, you're trying to, it takes me a minute to figure it out. You know, but let me tell you something. If it's poorly written, it's harder for me to speak. Because it's harder for me to come trippingly off the tongue, you know, because it's not well written. And a lot of times, you know, we had to deal with, whenever they pimp out the Crypt Keeper to do commercials or something like that, we get stuff where, you know, the copywriters had written it, not our writers. So their puns and their alliteration did not flow very well. And not only that, they would want to squeeze it into a shorter amount of time than the Crypt Keeper would ever be able to say it, because he said it so succinctly and so properly. And they're just going, based on HBO's Tales from the Crypt series. Okay, we can say that in 10 seconds. Based on the HBO's Tales from the Crypt series. You know, that's not 10 seconds. So then they wind up cutting it up when we get into the studio to make it fit. And then, you know, it was all funny and stuff like that. So, you know, there were challenges with it. There was some stuff that I used to improvise that I was about to shock. I remember doing, you know, I love a girl who'll give you head and then let you keep it. And they were like, and I never thought that would wind up on this show. But sure enough, there's an episode. He's sitting there, he's got a girl in bed with him, and her head falls off in his lap. And then he goes, I love a girl who'll give you head and then let you keep it. You know, so, you know, occasionally I would just be cracking them up. I would say stuff and wind up in the stuff. But we had good writers. I mean, to make this stuff work, you know, I mean, although these puns sound like so ridiculous sometimes, I have to do radio interviews. I have to do like 50-some radio interviews over 2 days leading up to each season. So I'd be driving somewhere in my car talking to, like, you know, Mark and Brian in LA or somebody in Bumfuck, you know, on the radio show. And they'd be asking the Crypt Keeper questions, and I'd have to answer as a Crypt Keeper and come up with stuff, you know? So I was constantly trying to come up with different sayings and speeches, you know, lead it towards those things. But every once in a while, something would come out that was just perfect, you know? And it was not easy, you know? So the writers come up with stuff and tweak that worked and landed, and, you know, and then also fed Kevin to come up with, you know, they had those commercials with, this is your brain on drugs, with a brain in a pan. You know, it's like, this is your brain on drugs. You know, the Crypt Keeper got it, and then with a hammer into it. This is your brain on tails from the Crypt. It smashes it all over the screen, you know. You know, it's clever. Like, does it sound clever when I say it? But it's clever because everybody had been seeing those spots for like 2 years. This is your brain on drugs campaign, you know, which was perfect. I mean, that also goes along with the whole anti-establishment part of Tales from the Crypt, because, you know, as soon as people told kids they couldn't read Tales from the Crypt comic books, it became controversial. Everybody's kid wanted them, you know? And not only did they want them, but, you know, their mothers were against it, tried to get comics to ban them. And as a result, their comic books all have the little seals. Ratings on them the way movies do. That was because of DC Comics and their variety of comic books and everything else from the Crypt. Hey, we all get out all the day, right? I think.
Any other questions?
With your very voice at the history and everything, is there a certain character type that you prefer or a certain genre that you tend to gravitate with?
You know, I mean, the games are fun, and there's a lot of them that are very realistic, you know. You know, like in Batman Arkham, which is not really realistic, but it's, you know, it takes place with a lot of characters in New York and that kind of stuff. And those are fun to do, but they don't really challenge me. Then there's the ones where I'm doing creatures, and I'm like, you know, all that kind of crap, and I hate them because they rip the shit out of my voice. It's like, can somebody make a military game without everybody screaming when they die? And there isn't a lot of that stuff. I used to do a lot of it to make a lot of the work again, and I can think of it. Those things, they replay a lot. So, you know, a lot of those things are years old. You know, they don't do as many new ones. And, you know, I got to listen to another cartoon.
Well, the characters talk like this.
You know, maybe kill myself. Yeah. And it's great. You know, I mean, that's especially good for kids, for little kids, because you got to make that stuff for kids. You got to get a little number of cartoons. It's the closest thing that Elizabeth Jennings a little kid can take, you know? And legally. And, I don't know what you're doing here. You know, so those are really fun to do. But a lot of the games and some of the cartoon stuff I get to do, you know, smack up adventure stories, and they have really good dialogue, and they have good actors, like, you know, they almost feel like Raiders of the Lost Ark, or those kind of adventure games. And those, for me, are the most fun, because I get to use the acting chops, I get to get into it with other good actors in the studio, and playing off each other, and that's a good time.
Well, thank you very much for your time.
My pleasure.
Thank you, Mr. Kassir.